This is the sign of matter's infinite. Now, in fact, that is the positive of matter, that matter has all these contents and it holds matter, sign of matter's infinite. The potentiality, the possibility, the dimensions of matter are really tremendous. And what you are seeing, this point here, this little spot, is actually a sign of the vastness of matter. It is out of matter till I have come to this point, and this point here is telling you, well, it is a bright, luminous, and therefore it is a sign, indication, a clue that there is something something present in matter itself also. This is the sign of matter's infinite. This, the weird puppet or the picture shown, picture, the painting. So why it is shown here? That matter has an infinite possibility, infinite potentiality. That is what it is shown here. And how it is shown here? To science, to reason, to thought, to religion. How this point is seen, this bright spot is seen by science, by reason, by thought, and by religion. He is describing this thing. Now, in fact, in Life Divine, there is a long description of science, its possibilities and potentialities, and he first discusses life, that it is the awareness of life. After all, what is science seeing? Science seeing is the process of formation of a form. But what is it that governs form of that? Science has no clue. And the materialistic basis is only that matter is able to produce that thing. But what for a citizen of that? It has no clue at all. In contrast to that, religion sees something higher than that, beyond the possibilities. But then it has not understood the matter at all completely. So he is giving here science, the gentlest measurer of her field. Science, the gentlest. Science is she. That knowledge is a feminine knowledge. Science knowledge, she is gentle. In Life Divine also, Shivananda speaks of science as she. She. Measurer of her faith. What does science do? Science is only a measurer. It takes a scale and just mass measures like that. It takes a clock and mass beats of time only. Beats of time only. Measures. In fact, that is what, in the word, measurer is basically the indication, the quality, the strength of mind. Mind is a measurer. Mind is a measuring instrument. Mind is an instrument of analysis and understanding. Analysis means you break, measure, and what one would call in Sanskrit, pramana. Mind means pramana, pramana. Scale, you see. Is a measurer. Which actually means that it is a mental process by which things are formed and understood, you see. Science, the measurer. And she posts on the record of her close survey, whatever she has seen, understood and all that thing. The entire paleontology, the entire evolution, the theory of biological evolution made by Darwin and all that thing. Well, all these things are correct. And it is making its own judgment. And ultimately, what does biologists say? That man has come from an ape. See, man has come from an ape. That is what biology would finally say. Actually, that is a big leap of imagination, even from the point of view of science. You have a certain kind of data, juxtaposition of data either, but you can't say that this is there and therefore this is there, and therefore you make a leap from man, from ape to man. That is an imagination. It is a leap of reason, leap of imagination. It has no scientific basis that really man has come from ape. That data is not there. See? So that is a kind of a, what shall I say, fallaciousness of scientific observation and deduction, you see. Actually, that is why Shivananda is very careful, very particular also. He says, man came not from ape, but from an ape-like being. is ape-like. The form may be similar, but then the ape-like creature is entirely of a different category than the ape proper. In other words, in the ape-like creature, the manomaya purusha, the mental being, is already working, which is not present in the ape. In the ape, who is working after? Chimpanzee. Who is working there? It is the animal mind. It is the mind of life which is working there, not the mind of mind, you see properly. So there is a kind of a differentiation. Now that happens only when the manomaya purusha enters into the pranamaya purusha. Then man appears on the scene, you see. Now that science cannot understand that kind of a thing, you see. The sign, the giant is measurer of her fame, as she posts the record of her close survey and mathematizes her huge external world. To reason, to science, this is what happens. Then to reason, bound within circle of sense. Whatever instruments are there, whatever instruments of perception are there, reason is bound by that rate. The data, the argument which goes there is based on what kind of data you get from senses. Senses inputs, you see. To science, to reason, or in thought's broad, impalpable exchange, a speculator in tenuous, vast ideas, abstraction to the void, her currency, her of science, her currency. We know not what form values for its base. Really, you see, the scientific theories are not absolute truths. They keep on changing. They may last for 10 years, 20 years, 100 years, a century or so, but then you find another theory coming out, you see. The formulation of truth, of understanding of the depths of things, is a kind of a provisional understanding of science. It is not the truth by itself, you see. Now, well, science says that we entirely go by data. On the basis of what data we have got, this is what we understand today. If new data is added, new features come into view, into examination, then accordingly we will modify our theory. And we do modify our theory. Scientists, we keep on doing that. There was no quantum mechanics before 1927. But now the whole world has completely changed. The entire view of things has completely changed, you see. The Newtonian dynamics has undergone a total change of causality into probabilistic theory. You see. So the formulation, the conclusions of science in that sense are provisional. There are certain truths which will always be there. But then, they are not really truth, they are facts. We have to make a distinction between facts and truth. Water under normal conditions, standard temperature and pressure and all that, will always boil at 100 degrees centigrade, wherever it be. So, nobody can change that kind of, whether it is in England or in Paris or in Netherlands or in India or wherever it be, that is a fix, you see. That is a fact, but that is not science, that is not scientific truth. Scientific theory. It will become a scientific theory when science tries to tell you why under these conditions water boils only at 100 degrees centigrade. Why? If it is able to answer that question, then it becomes a theory, it becomes a speculation. But science does not touch that. It only accepts the fact. So the facts are all right, but the theories which are there in understanding the facts, they keep on changing. Abstractions in voice, currency. Only, now, so here dismiss science. Only religion in this bankruptcy of science, of reason, of abstraction, of mathematization. Only religion in this bankruptcy presents its dubious riches to our heart. So whatever riches reason the religion is going to present, religion is going to speak of higher powers of life, working man, higher powers. It believes that there are superior powers, greater powers, which can enter into our life and operate in us. Religion believes that, you see. God, goddesses, whatever you want to call them, they are present there. Supernatural powers are there. Only religion. In this bankruptcy, bankruptcy of science and religion, of science and thought and reason, in this bankruptcy of science, presents a dubious. So whatever religion is presenting, that also is dubious. One religion will say this kind of heaven, the other religion will say that kind of heaven. A Vaishnava might say, my heaven is Vaikuntha. A Shaivite will say, my heaven is Kailasha. See, each religion has its own heaven and all its own kind of a thing, you see. Present is dubious riches to our hand. Our science and provision checks on the beyond. That is what religion is doing, you see. You are signing, but whether the check will be valid or not, will be recognized, accepted or not, will be valid or not, it has no idea at all. Well, let me sign the check on the name of God, but whether God will accept your sign or not, who knows? The priest will come, the padres will come, the fathers will come. Do you sign the check? But then heaven has its own way of looking at these things, you see. Yeah, even our pujari, they say, okay, I have offered the puja, now God will give the present to you, the gift, you see. Here you go and give flowers, give this thing, then puja, he will chant some mantra and all that. So I had done my job, now it is up to God. Now whether God will accept that thing as a check or not, nobody knows, you see. Maybe in his own wisdom, he will reject your prayer. You may go to the temple and do a worship and ask for something. But God knows something better for you, in your interest, greater interest, and therefore it may reject your prayer. And it is also an act of grace. It is also an act of grace. If he rejects your prayer, that is also an act of grace. Well, presents dubious riches to our hand, or signs unprovisioned checks on the beyond. Beyond, because we have absolutely no access to it. God is there, okay, but we have no access. Our poverty is there, it's revenge. We are poor, we are ignoble creatures, we are mortal, we are defective, but all that thing will go away up there, but it is a provisional check. Whether that check will be accepted or not, nobody knows. The only guarantee is your psychic assurance. Your psychic assurance. If your psychic being is alert, active, and if it is, do this, do that, go that, then you are absolutely, whatever psychic says, does, offers, if you do that, that check is accepted by God, by the divine. That check by the psychic, not by the mind, not by the life force, by other aspects of nature, only the psychic, it is a direct response to the superior powers. Our poverty shall have its revenge. Our spirits depart, discarding a futile life. So, whether you go through science or whether you go through religion, ultimately our spirits depart, discarding. This is a futile life, ultimately. Well, this futile life, this is specifically in the context of the religion. Our spirits depart, discarding a futile life. Enter the black unknown. Enter the black unknown. Well, that spirit depart into the black unknown, that pertains to science and reason and thought. It does not know where it goes. Our spirits depart into the black unknown. What happens? Science cannot tell you. You die and you don't. Science is unable to tell you what has happened to you, where you are, what happened to you. Absolutely no idea at all. Hey, into the black unknown. Or with them, take death's passport. With the spirits depart, take death's passport into immortality. May you die on the basis of religion, you are promoted to go to the immortal world. You see? So you die, you take passport from the death, and then you are in heaven, in paradise, whatever you want to call it, you see. So science will lead you to black unknown. Religion will lead you possibly to immortality after death. After death. But as far as this life is concerned, there is no solution. Neither science offers any solution, any clue, nor religion in that sense. Actually, in the theories of evolution, Shivan speaks of science, religion, occultism, spiritual mind, and then the higher mind. After mind, he speaks of the spiritual mind, all the way up to our mind. Spiritual mind with all your faculties awakened. Spiritual mind consists of your higher mind, illumined mind, intuition, over mind. These are the ranges of spiritual mind beyond our reason, beyond reason. The spiritual mind can awaken and go up to the over mind, be in the company of the gods and live there also. But then that is also not of meaning. Yet, this was only a provisional scheme.